أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. قل ما يعبأ بكم ربي لولا دعاؤكم.
You know, there are plenty of ayats in the Holy Quran that talks about the importance and significance of the prayers, the asking of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or in Arabic called du'a. You see, we have two types of prayers. Salat in the language of Arabic means prayers, the prayers that we do, the asking of Allah. Then, technically, it has been used for the ritual that we perform. The du'a is more general than the salat that we do, meaning that you ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for what you need. If you look it through the holy secret, you see there are plenty of verses that admonish people, admonish Muslims to ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and do the worships, do the prayers. Among them is this ayah that I recited. God, Jalla wa Ala, says, قُلْ مَا يَعْبَأُ بِكُمْ رَبِّي لَوْلَا دُعَاءُكُمْ. You're worth nothing in the eyes of God. Your values considered to be nothing unless you do the worships. Please, sisters, keep those two little kids quiet. Yeah, you can take it. صلى على محمد وآل.
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد.
So the ayah says that your worth, your value is in your prayers. If you do the prayers, you will gain value in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When you look at the ayat, the verses that came to, you know, to tell the Muslims about the fasting regarding Ramadan, after they finish, first it says, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا كُتِبَ عَلَيْكُمُ الصِّيَامُ كَمَا كُتِبَ عَلَى الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ. Then another ayah says, شَهْرُ رَمَضَانَ الَّذِي أُنزِلَ فِيهِ الْقُرْآنِ, and continues like that. At the end of those verses, when it's finished, it talks about this ayah, stresses upon the importance of the dua, supplications and prayers. It says, وَإِذَا سَأَلَكَ عِبَادِي عَنِّي فَإِنِّي قَرِيبٌ أُجِيبُ دَعْوَةَ الدَّاعِي إِذَا دَعَانِ. If my servants have asked you about me, then tell them that I am so close to them. You see, brothers and sisters, this ayah did not come in coincidence with the ayahs of fasting. There must be a relationship between the holy month of Ramadan and between the supplications and the prayers. Ramadan is considered to be the season of the prayers, the promotion of the prayers. At the time that you will get the utmost benefit from your prayers is during the holy month of Ramadan. I have recited the khutbah, the sermons of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, for you at the beginning. Here's the beautiful wordings again. It says, in the holy month, du'a'ukum fihi mustajab. Your prayers have been accepted by Allah. Then tell us what to do. What is the time of the prayers, brothers and sisters? Please pay attention. It says, وَرْفَعُوا إِلَيْهِ أَيْدِيَكُمْ بِالدُّعَاءِ فِي أَوْقَاتِ صَلَوَاتِكُمْ. Those prayers that we do, the five daily prayers, those are the best time for asking Allah, for besieging Him to get what you need. وَارْفَعُوا إِلَيْهِ أَيْدِيَكُمْ بِالدُّعَاءِ فِي أَوْقَاتِ صَلَوَاتِكُمْ فَإِنَّهَا أَفْضَلُ الصَّلَاةِ أَفْضَلُ السَّاعَةِ. Month of Ramadan is the best month of the year. The best times, the best hours of Ramadan is the times of the prayers. This noon prayers, once there is time for Adhan, the 10 minutes, the 15 minutes, do your prayers, and right after, do the dua. Do your asking, whatever you want to ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. فَإِنَّهَا أَفْضَلُ السَّاعَاتِ يَنْظُرُ اللَّهُ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ فِيهَا بِالرَّحْمَةِ إِلَىٰ عِبَادِهِ. Puts a term with mercy. يُجِيبُهُمْ إِذَا نَاجُوا. If you talk to him, he won't answer you. وَيُلَبِّيهُمْ إِذَا نَادُوا. If you call upon him, he
He will call upon you. وَيَسْتَجِيبُ لَهُمْ إِذَا دَعَوْا.
When they ask him, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give them whatever they ask.
You see, brothers and sisters, in the Islamic literature, dua is considered مُخِّ الْعِبَادِ. We have a narration from the Prophet, peace be upon him. He says, الدُعَاء مُخُّ الْعِبَادِ, meaning the brain, the mind of the prayers, of the entire worship. Why? What do we do in worship? Why do we worship Allah? When we worship Allah, we put ourselves in a position of a need. Someone who is in need, in total need, and total subordination to the Lord. That's what the dua is. When we ask Allah, what do we mean? We need it. We mean that we are so desperate. We are so needy, therefore we ask the Lord. Therefore the dua become the brain, the head of the worship. Those who reject to do the dua, basically they don't like to worship God. Here, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has this ayah. It says, وَقُلْ دُعُونِي أَسْتَجِبْ لَكُمْ. Ask me. Pray for me so I would answer you. Those who shy away, who turn away from my worship, do not do my dua. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ يَسْتَكْبِرُونَ عَنْ عِبَادَتِي سَيَدْخُلُونَ جَهَنَّمَ دَاخِلِينَ. Those who do not do the prayers, do not do the worship and dua and supplications, those will be, you know, ready to go to the hellfire. Why? Because basically I am so arrogant, seeing myself needless from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. While the dua, the supplication, is silah al-mu'min. It is the weapon by which mu'min defend himself. We have a narration from Imam Ali alayhi salam. Says الدعاء سلاح المؤمن وعمود الدين ونور السماوات والأرض. It is with the dua you will defend yourself. You can live proper life. It is with this dua. Now there is a fallacy, especially in the, you know, in the minds of the critics about Islam. They say that the dua, when you ask, when you put yourself in the position of a need and ask other ones, basically you are depending and relying on others. That will create laziness among yourselves. You know, and instead of being vigorous and self-reliant and intelligent, thinking about the solution to my problems, I resort to something that is supernatural. While those problems that I face every day, those are all natural. Materialistic. I need money, I have to work. I need a car, I have to provide for it. I have to get a home, I have to get married, and things like that. And instead of becoming, you know, resourceful and intelligent and practical and find my own solution, I rely on something metaphysical, superstition, you know, and ask that entity to solve my own problem. Basically, I don't want to face my own problem. That will cause a culture of reliance and dependence. And just look at the Muslim cultures, look at the Muslim nations, you see that they are full of dependence on others. Reliance on others. If others don't solve the problems for them, they never get to solve their own problems. In one part, this argument is true, unfortunately, brothers. If you look at the Muslim culture, you see they are heavily dependent on others. Even the cup of water to drink, we have to ask others to pour it for us. In some Muslim countries, you see that the majority of the population, 80% of the population, are foreigners. They do everything for them, from defense, to culture, to economy, to art, to football. Everything is all made from the foreigners. The natives themselves are just, you know, rare commodities. They are tourists in the city. They don't know what's going on. This is too much reliance on others. And it is true. Not only, you know, those Arab countries, the majority of Muslim countries. For any reason, we need to pick up the phone and call Washington and call the European countries and European capitals to ask them to solve our own problems. We cannot stand up for the salvation of our own problem. and this is a terrible culture. But when you look at Islam itself, through the history of Islam, you do not find any more religion and faith have emphasized on self-reliance and work as much as Islam did. Look at the life of the Prophet, peace be upon him. Where do you see that the Prophet go and resort to the masjid, only does the prayers while the enemy gathers and makes plans to attack the city? Not even a single time. You see that Islam always emphasizes on what? مَنْ لَا مَعَاشَ لَهُ لَا مَعَادَلَ. Someone who does not have a means of living, this person also has lost his hereafter. His religion is also lost. Not only his life here. The hereafter is also life. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi while was in Medina, he used to do the planning. He used to think. To do the strategies, prepare for the enemy. Make economic solution, social solution, all kind of solutions he used to do for the people of Medina, and would counterweight the attack of the enemies when they would gather and plan for, you know, raiding the city of Medina. The Prophet, peace be upon him, would do the same planning to counterweight them, and during the fight he would wear his battle attire, the armor, and would go into the battle and fight. He wouldn't stand up in the corner of the masjid and say, oh Allah, the enemy has attacked us, please help us. Do something to help us. No, rather he used to work, hard work. One day he was given a sermon on the pulpit, he saw a worker, a single worker, who used to work outside of the Medina and came with a few goods. When the Prophet came down from the pulpit, he went and grabbed the hand of the worker and kissed it. Kissed the hand of the worker. That much emphasis the Prophet, peace be upon him, gave to working, to showing, you know, ability to do work. In one incident, in one story, they say a man came to the Prophet and told him, Ya Rasulullah, I need to feed my family. I have a large family, I just need 2 dirhams. 2 dirhams, give it to me so I can provide food for him. The Prophet took 2 dirhams, told him, I give you the 2 dirhams, but you cannot go and buy food and give it to your family. Rather, I want you to go and buy axe, you know what axe is? That cut out the wood. He told him, go buy that one, and next week I need the 2 dirhams from you back. I'm lending you those 2 dirhams. The man took the 2 dirhams, went and bought the tool, went outside of the city in the farms, cut a few woods and logs and brought them to the city. He sold them. Next week he came to the Prophet and said, Ya Rasulullah, those are your 2 dirhams. Take them back. Now I have 6 dirhams in my pocket, additional dirham. Plus I made my family, you know, full. Their stomach is full. Therefore the Prophet, peace be upon him, always was encouraging people to do work. And God has done the same thing. وَأَنْ لَيْسَ لِلْإِنسَانِ إِلَّا مَا سَعَى وَأَنَّ سَعْيَهُ سَوْفَ يُرَى. The harder you work, the better you will be. There is another ayah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَقُلْ اَعْمَلُوا فَسَيَرَى اللَّهُ عَمَلَكُمْ وَرَسُولُهُ وَالْمُؤْمِنُونَ. Always admonishment for hard work, for achievement. You cannot find any faith as much as Islam, who pursue people, his followers, to go after work and achievement. However, the prayers is a school of thought, brothers and sisters. It's a school of discipline, a school of behavior. It teaches discipline and behavior when we do the supplications. I will tell you 3 examples. Number one, brothers and sisters, is that I touched upon that last night, probably, or the night before. Human being, by self, spiritually weak, we tend to forget. Once we acquire wealth, health, and power, we declare ourselves needless from anything. But when we do the prayers, when we put ourselves in a position of a need to a superpower who always keep us under surveillance and check us, we know that we are always in need of them. we will overcome this problem. We think that we are a big thing. And here Quran, you know, emphasizes on this. It says, then يريد الإنسان ليفجر أمامه. Once insan finds out that he doesn't have any problem, he doesn't have headache, he's not suffering from any illness, there is money in his pocket, his stomach is full, he's not afraid of any other human being or any animal, he keeps attacking people. Who will challenge, he challenges God. يَسْأَلُ أَيَّانَ يَوْمُ الْقِيَامَةِ. In another ayah, it says, كَلَّا إِنَّ الْإِنسَانَ لَيَضْغَى أَنْ رَآهُ اسْتَغْنَى. Once he sees the money, you know, handful of money, he becomes so revolting. He will revolt against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So arrogant. You know, the vanity of insan is too much. He doesn't see the far future. Only see the position, the time that he is, the situation that he is in. In fact, insan is one of the weakest creatures. There's a beautiful, elegant saying from Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salam. Says, Miskeen ibn Adam, تؤذيه البطة وتقتله الشرقة وتنتله العرقة. Human being, if a tiny little bug sting him, he cannot sit, you know. He becomes restless. Tiny little mosquito, tiny little bug, tiny little bacteria. A single virus can destroy the entire human being, the entire existence of a human being. Maybe Ali ibn Abi Talib was referring to the microscopic germs, you know, those tiny little things. I remember when I was a kid, at that time we used to hear about the epidemic of cholera. Everywhere they were talking about cholera. At the school, at kindergarten, they used to tell us, wash your hand because there is cholera. There are so many people dying in this country and in that country. Here it's there. This is the number of death in this country, this is the number of death in that country. I remember this very well. After that, we started to hear about cancer. Later on, we heard about AIDS. Later on, we heard about bird flu, then swine flu. And every single day, we get to see one of those tiny little organisms who come to challenge a human being. Ibn Abi Talib is referring to those things. There are a few statistics I would like to share it with you. For example, AIDS, we have worldwide 35 million people who have been, you know, infected with HIV, the virus that causes this disease, the AIDS. In 2010, there were 1.8 million people who have died from this disease. Only in Africa, 16.6 million orphans have been developed due to this disease, the AIDS. Malaria, however, in 2010, there were 3.3 billion who were at risk of malaria. Malaria is tiny little, you know, organism. It belongs to, as far as I remember, it's yeast problem. It's even yeast, not bacteria, nor virus. It's a yeast. Now, it causes about 3.3 billion people who are at risk. Now, 216 million cases have been reported up to 2010. 216 million cases of malaria. Out of those, 655,000 died in 1 year. More than 500,000 people died due to this malaria. Meaning that every day, 1,800 people died. Every hour, 75 people died from this disease. Ali ibn Abi Talib says that if this human being was so powerful, he could overcome malaria at least. You know? Why is it though? So here the Imam Ar-Ridha alayhi salam has a beautiful, elegant hadith. Says, كُلَّمَا أَحْدَثَ الْعِبَادُ مِنَ الذُّنُوبِ مَا لَنْ يَكُونُوا يَعْلَمُونَ أَحْدَثَ اللَّهُ لَهُمْ مِنَ الْبَلَاءِ مَا لَنْ يَكُونُوا يَعْرِفُونَ. Every time you become inventive in making sense, you see, crimes, sinful, God will give us, punish us with a new kind of disease, with a new kind of virus. We will not stop at bird flu and swine flu. Tomorrow you will have the, you know, the monkey flu, maybe human flu, all kind of flus. You know, fish flu, inshallah, in the near future. Due to what? Due to our own sins. Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salam says that miskin ibn Adam, this human being, is so weak. وَتَقْتُلُهُ الشَّرْطَ. A tiny little particle, solid particle, gets in the, from the esophagus, goes to the trachea, where we breathe. If it's a clot, we become history. وَتُمْتِنُهُ الْعَرْضَ. Imagine we don't take a shower for 3 days. What will happen to us for 1 week? What kind of smell you become? This is Ibn Adam. This is what Ibn Adam is. So when we do the prayers of brothers and sisters, we know that someone is watching. And we are always in constant need for him. It is out of his mercy that he has given us all the blessings that we live today. But we take it for granted. We never think that I am healthy today. I never take it, you know, seriously that today I am fit and healthy, can speak, can talk. When do I realize my health? When I fell on the bed. At that time I would say, oh, what, you know, what wonderful time I had. At that time I could talk to my brothers, I could stand up for 1 hour and give a speech. Now what is happening to me? This is the blessing that we tend to oversee all the time. So, this is number one. Number two, insan is emotionally also weak, not only physically weak. You see, brothers and sisters, there are many of us that get, I'm sorry, spiritually weak. We get agitated for no reason. The door of sin is so easily open in our face, either due to rage, or lust, or money, or any type of things. We become agitated, we rush into that, and we lose ourselves. Some of us by money, some of us by loss, some of us by post, some of us due to rage, we become sinners. We lose our tempers. We lose our own humanity. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saying that with the prayers you keep in touch. You stay in line. You don't forget yourself. You see, Shaytan is very resourceful, very intelligent. When he comes to lure us, for example, if someone is alim, scholar, he doesn't come and tell him to do adultery or drink wine, for example. No. What does he tell him? He tells him, if someone asks you and you don't know the answer, you get the answer. Give a fatwa even if you do not answer. You are the believer, yes. You don't commit adultery. You don't go out to nightclubs. But what does he come tell you? Your brother today is not here. Talk against him. You know, backbite him. Make fun of him. This is how Shaytan comes in. Tells a marja, tells a mujtahid, or a religious cleric, tells him, if you don't know the answer, don't say I don't know it. Give the answer. And anyway, misguide the people. You see, there is a great alim who was known as Muhaqqiq al-Qumi, as far as I remember, if I'm not mistaken. In his trip from, he used to live in Qum, I guess. One of his trips, he used to go to Khorasan, Mashhad for the ziyarah. Meanwhile, we stopped in a city. The people announced to the villagers around the city that this great alim is coming to the masjid and staying for 1 day there. If you have any question, come and ask him. So people flocked to the masjid and they kept asking him. One particular group of people came from a long distant village. When they came, they asked him, the first question they asked him, he said, this time I don't remember. They asked him a second question. Again, he thought, he said, believe me, I don't remember now the answer. A third question they asked him, again, he said, I don't know. I don't remember what, you know, what is in my fatwa that I can answer. They said, Sayyidina, if we go back to our villagers, we say to the people that we asked the Grand Marja 3 questions, He said, I don't know. Is that okay? He said, don't tell them the three questions. Tell them thousands of problems he doesn't know. Not only one question or two questions. You see, brothers and sisters, it is not shame of someone who says, I don't know. It is shame when you give a wrong answer. When you can follow, read, and do things, but you don't, rather you make up from your own the answer. Especially in fiqh and usul. I've seen, if you remember yesterday, I said, unfortunately, here in North America, we have plenty of those self-declared mujtahid and maraj. For reason or another, they give a fatwa from their own. You have to be careful. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you know, has made a road that you look into, you learn from. So this is what shaitan does. Comes to the mu'mineen and tell them do something that they are inclining to do. You see, in the battle of Yemen, you had one side, Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salam, on the other side, you had, you know, the wife of the Prophet and two of the companions, Talha and Zubayr. Talha and Zubayr used to fight over Salat al-Subh, who would advance the people to do the prayer, to become the Imam. They came under the banner that they are fighting for justice against Ali ibn Abi Talib, but they used to fight for the prayers, for the Jama'ah prayers. Aisha told them, neither you nor you. I'll bring Abdullah ibn Zubayr, my nephew. And her nephew used to lead the prayers. Here is the shaitan. Here is the place of shaitan comes to lure people. So through our prayers, brothers and sisters, when we do the prayers, we get connected to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We tend to forget our daily life. And the low desires that we are inflicted. This is number two. Number three, you see, psychology, research, and studies have shown that when you are facing tremendous challenge or you go through trouble, that trouble agonizes you. You have to disclose it. Studies have shown those who disclose their troubles, their problems, their agonies to others, for example, to their parents, to their confidants, to their relatives, to their children, they will feel better. They would psychologically can handle the situation. While that person who always swallows up and put it in has two ways. Either he will explode sometime, or he will face depression. Those who have depression, one cause of the depression is that you see that they are quiet. They never discuss their problem. Why? Because we have only certain ability to handle the pressure. Other than that, we break. We cannot. Therefore, it is recommended psychologically and religiously that tell your problem, but to whom? To your brother mu'min, someone who listens to you. You see, we have a narration says that if you have a problem and you disclose it to someone that is non-believer, you are in fact complaining about God. But when you tell your mu'min brother or mu'min sister, you tell your problem to them, basically you are complaining to God Himself, talking to God, bringing your grievance to God. You see my point? So the psychology today say that disclose your problems. Don't keep it within yourself. If you keep it within yourself, you will run into trouble. You will be either depressed or you become violent. And Imam al-Baqir alayhi salam tells his follower that إِذَا ضَاقَتْ عَلَيْكَ الْأُمُورِ, if you see there is no way and you are so depressed, full of agonies and problems, أُحْفُرْ لِنَفْسِكَ حُفْرًا وَبُحْ فِيهَا, if you do not find someone else, dig a well and talk to the well. At least give it to something. Say it, don't keep it to yourself. We have narrations, stories from Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salam, who would see faces the troubles of his followers and the enemy, what he used to do. He could not disclose it even to the closest people to him. He would go outside after Salat al-Isha, in the midst of dark, he would leave the town, go in the middle of the desert, One day one companion was going with him. He asked the companion to stay in place and told him, don't follow me. I will go and come back to you. Took longer than usual. The follower chased him. When he chased him, he saw that Ali ibn Abi Talib is putting his head in a well and talking, saying something. The follower told him, what are you doing, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen? He said, did you hear what I said? He said, no, I did not. The Amir alayhi salam gave this poetry. He said, وَفَ الصَّدْرِ لُبَانَاتٌ إِذَا ضَاقَ لَهَا صَدْرِ. There are difficult issues in my heart that I cannot disclose. When I have it there, حَفَرْتُ الْأَرْضَ بِالْكَفِّ وَأَبْدَيْتُ لَهَا صَدْرِ. I dig a hole in the ground and I tell my secrets to that thing. فَمَحْمَّا تَنْبِتُ الْأَرْضِ فَذَاكَ النَّبْتُ مِنْ بَدْرِ. If you see that there is a plant, there is a tree, in that area, this is all from my seeds. I have put this seed in here. That was Ali ibn Abi Talib. Why? Because he was feeling alone. Lonely. Ali ibn Abi Talib was lonely. He was not in the right place or in the right time with the right people. Therefore, this is how he used to relieve himself. Now imagine, if we talk to someone who himself is in need, some himself is a deficient, give us so much relief. You know, we will be elated, we will be relieved if we talk to someone just like us. What about if we talk to someone who really has the solution? To Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We know that He's the Lord and the keys to everything that is in His hand. Wouldn't that give us much relief? And we know that truly it is in His hand. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can solve our problems in a minute. كُنْ فَيَكُونَ. Within split of second, things can happen without even saying it. You see, there is elegant phrase in the dua. It says, ذَلَّتْ لِقُدْرَتِكَ الصِّعَابِ وَتَسَدَّبَتْ بِقُدْرَتِكَ الْأَسْبَابِ وَجَرَى بِقُدْرَتِكَ الْقَضَاءِ. All of those things happen with your own power. Then it says, وَمَضَتْ عَلَىٰ إِرَادَتِكَ الْأَشْيَاءِ. Everything will follow your own will. How? فَهِيَ بِمَشِيئَتِكَ دُونَ قَوْلِكَ مُقْتَنَىٰ. Without even you say a word, God does not even need to say kun. By itself, happens. فَهِيَ بِمَشِيئَتِكَ دُونَ قَوْلِكَ مُقْتَنَىٰ وَبِإِرَادَتِكَ دُونَ نَهْيِكَ مُنْزَجَىٰ. Without even you say no, things will not happen. Merely by your own will. Shouldn't we talk to that person? Shouldn't we put our own agonies, our own complaints to him? You see, if you remember yesterday, last night, I said, the most repulsive thing is when someone asks someone else that is just like him, a human being. But when it gets to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that thing becomes the most noble thing. وَاسْأَلُ اللَّهَ مِنْ فَضْلِهِ. Ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But unfortunately, we ask when we are in need, when we are desperate. But once we feel that we are needless, we forget about that. We forget about Lord, we forget about the prayers. 10 years passes, we don't even stop in masjid. As if we don't even know where the masjid is. But once we have problem, we start to do salatul layl. We do all kind of du'as and prayers and supplications, so that thing to be done. Here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَإِذَا أَنْعَمْنَا عَلَى الْإِنسَانِ. When we give him something valuable, أَعْرَضَ وَنَأَى بِجَانِبِهِ. This is no, it's all due to me. I have made it. وَإِذَا مَسَّهُ الشَّرْ فَذُو دُعَاءٍ عَلِيهُ. Once he has tiny little problem, then you will see a long complaint. Oh Allah, why is only me? Why did this? You do this to me? Why am I have been chosen among so many people? I have been worshipping, I have been nice, I didn't do anything. Complaining and complaining. This is a human being. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, do the prayers at any time. Don't leave it to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Don't leave it only during the dangerous time, during difficult time. Ask at any time. Ask at ease so you will get the answer, you know, during the difficulty. It says, اذكر ربك في الرضا يذكرك في الشدة. اذكر ربك في الرخاء. During the time that you are having good time, in leisure time, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala remember you during the time of shiddah. أسأل الله سبحانه وتعالى أن يوفقنا للدعاء وللإنابة وللصلاة وللصيام وللقيام. Yes, please. اللهم اغفر للمؤمنين والمؤمنات والمسلمين والمسلمات الأحياء منهم والأموات. تابع بيننا وبينهم بالخيرات، إنك مجيب الدعوات، إنك قاضي الحاجات، إنك على كل شيء قدير. وصلى الله على محمد وآله الطيبين الطاهرين.
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد.
جزاك الله. There is a question. It says that I have talked about disclosing the problems, but culturally we are taught to be patient. You know. So where is the border? Will be complaining, will be complaining and impatience if we talk? You see, sister, there is a borderline between impatience and patience, and between disclosing things and keeping things into themselves. Should not be, you know, should not be messed up between the two. Disclosing the problem doesn't mean that you are impatient. You see, you have a problem, you face a problem. You need a solution. God doesn't tell you that to stay in your place until you die. Don't find the solution. You know, you let's say you run out of money. How would you survive? Saints keeping everything in the heart and say, I have to be patient for that. Yes, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants you to be patient in the means that you know that all the destiny in His hand. If it's suitable for you, God will solve the problem. If it's not, you would not solve the problem. We have a full trust in God. But it doesn't mean that you do not try and solve the problem. If you remember, I said, if you disclose the problem to your believer, to your sister believer, or brother believer, brother mu'min, in fact, you're not complaining. You are asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Why? Because He's a mu'min like you. He's a believer like you. You will find a solution to that. But where does the patience and, you know, and impatience is? It's when we become despair, meaning that we have all despair and keep, you know, rejecting the idea. I remember I have seen recently a person stop doing the prayers. He stopped, he's not praying. Told him why. He said, because I had you know, an emotional problem. I was engaged and then the engagement was bad. I asked Allah so many times to fix the problem, He didn't. Therefore, I stopped praying. This is a despair. First of all, this is a shallow-mindedness, number one. And this is God's despair. You, if you run into such a problem, ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, try to solve it. Maybe you talk to someone who knows your partner well, he can talk to her and, you know, and mend the bridges again. But showing despair, meaning that you reject the entire hope and say, okay, since God didn't solve my problem, then I will. This is called impatience. There is a difference between the two, between seeking a solution for a problem and for being in despair that you reject the call of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Okay, inshallah, there is no more questions. صلى على محمد وآل محمد.
اللهم